Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We are going to get started, so please take a seat. For those of you in back, you can come a bit closer. There are just a couple of housekeeping announcements I'd like to make this morning. It's very important, as we mentioned yesterday, to take a look at your daily update, which I hope all of you received when you came in. If not, you'll find many copies. We do have a few important changes today that I just want to mention briefly. First of all, unfortunately, even though it's hard to imagine that there could be anything other than perfect weather anywhere in the country looking outside, Curtis Sittenfeld was not able to come in for a session that she was scheduled to do, so that is canceled this morning. In its place, though, at 10:30 this morning, in the Heinz room of the Kresge building, and you can get directions to that and see it on your map, we have something that should be really very special. For those of you who've been here before, you know that each year we commission a special poll by one of the leading pollsters in the country, Doug Schoen. And Doug will be presenting that poll, looking at the American people's reactions to the first 6 months of the Obama administration. He's going to be presenting the poll at 10:30 in the Heinz room. For those of you who can't be there and are interested, we will also be putting that on our website. That is something exclusively done for the Aspen Ideas Festival each year and has always been extremely popular. The other changes, the plight of the auto industry had been scheduled for 2:30. That is now going to be at 10:30 in the Greenwald Pavilion, in the Greenwald tent. The roundtable on science literacy had been scheduled to be at 10:30, is now going to be at 2:30 in the Lauder Room. And again, all of these things you will find in here. And the roundtable on financial regulation is changing its rooms at 10:30. It's moving, and again, you will find all of this here. It is now my great pleasure to introduce this morning's panel, an enormously important topic. To introduce our panelist will be our moderator. You've already met him. Many of you have. Charles Ogletree, very distinguished professor of law at Harvard Law School, also the founding director of the Houston Institute for Race and Justice. And a final little reminder, if you would please, there are thousands, literally thousands of people who will be listening to this presentation and watching it, a video and audio, and for that I ask you to please turn off your cell phones and smartphones or put them in an airplane mode, because even if you're sitting in the middle of the audience, it does provide interference on our recording. Charles Ogletree, thank you.
Good morning, and I'm very happy to be here. It's been a very exciting conference here in Aspen, and I have the great pleasure of interviewing one of my sheroes. I've been told that shero is not a word, but I'm going to use that word for this amazing woman who many of you know. Marian Wright Edelman's from Bentonville in South Carolina, where her mother and father eventually grew up, is a graduate of Yale Law School at a time when people like her, that is, blacks and women, were few in number. And with all of that great education, what did she do? She spent her time as a civil rights lawyer and going to a place with a little challenge, the state of Mississippi. Hopefully during the course of this conversation, we'll be able to talk a little bit about Bob Moses. We're also going to talk about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And to sort of put into context this journey from the 60s to the present and why she is so committed to the future of our children. In order to start this, we wanted to show a short video that you'll be able to see on the screens here. I'm sorry for those who are listening. I won't be able to see it. But the video about what we're talking about with the cradle-to-prison pipeline and how it impacts our children. I'll see if Dr. Edelman wants to set it up before we show it, the first part of it, and then we'll conclude with the part of it as well.
Well, the video has the wonderful voice of Yolanda Adams and wonderful photos, horrible photos, that Steve Liss, a Time magazine photographer, was able to go into Texas institutions and take. And I think it shows you the problem better than any thousands of words that I, a Charles, could say. And so it lays it out, and we'll talk about it. But then at the end, we'll show you the second half, which is hope. I think it lays out the choices. We can go this way, and put more and more children in prison, or we can begin to put into place the preventive services and early intervention services and rebuild our families and communities and send every child to successful adulthood and college and work. So you'll see the first part now, and you'll see the second part later.
And let me just remind you, it's pretty graphic, so but it's real. And in order to deal with the problem of how children are treated, and I would say mistreated in our society of every race and gender and age, I think it sets a tone for what we have to do in addressing the issue of the cradle to prison pipeline. So,
if I would just say one more thing. A woman had seen this in Boston a year ago, and she said, what country was this in? I said, the country of Texas. And it was the year 2006, and so these are the realities of what children are living with every day, and we can change it.
Great. So can we have the video?
Children!
It sets a very graphic and troubling scene when you talk about children. Let me start by asking you this. All your experience, all your life, all the things you've been able to do, why children? There's education, there's health care, there's housing, there's environment. Why did you say my life's work is going to be in trying to save and improve the lives of children?
Because I grew up with parents who believe that the purpose of adults and families was to make sure that the next generation had what they needed to make the world and nation better. And that, you know, when you look at the civil rights movement, it was all about children. They wanted their children to have a better education, and they were prepared to sacrifice, to lose their jobs, to be bombed, and to go through everything in order for their children to have a better life than they had. All of these are issues of children. You can't deal with it. You know, children don't come in pieces. Children come in families, and families come in communities, and communities are affected by their state and local policies and by the culture and by the nation's priorities. And so when you really focus on children, you are focusing on everything. And if the child is safe, the child is healthy, all of us are safe, all of us are healthy. As a civil rights lawyer, it became very clear to me that after the civil rights movement, that we hadn't finished our job, and that I could win the school desegregation case, but if the next day my plaintiffs were thrown out of their homes, were harassed, were bombed, were jobless, were hungry, that one had to take care of that. And secondly, that political and civil rights, very important as a framework, without economic rights, didn't add up to justice, and you had to have you have to put meat on the bones of opportunity. And so what I do for children is an attempt to try to prevent these problems from occurring in the first place. Frederick Douglass believed a long time ago that it's so much easier to build a healthy child than to repair a broken man. Mm. And it was also very clear in the late 60s in Mississippi that whatever you call black and poor was going to face a shrinking constituency, and that we had to find new ways of building new constituencies across race and income. And children seem to make sense because, again, if you cannot solve the problems of children without changing families, communities, and the priorities of a nation. And so it's both the important thing to do, I think that's why we're on this earth, is to you know, to make sure that we continue as a people, and that's children. I mean, Tagore said that, you know, children are God's messengers, that he's not yet given up on humanity. And so that if we've got our jobs to do to make sure that humanity continues and that the next generation does better than we do. And one of the disturbing things is that we're moving backwards. A third of black children are not going to do as well as their parents, and many, many other children are not going to do as well because we adults have really abandoned, I think, our responsibility to
and
the next generation.
And that's changed. The whole idea was that you, as the child, would have a better life than your parents. The whole idea is that each generation will
be better.
Right? And that's changed. Let's take a step back. Because you talk about your parents, Reverend Wright, your father, his discipline and focus on saving you, and your mother's incredible creativity and gift to think about institution building, even when you're young. How do they each influence you?
Oh, I had great parents. I mean, and everything starts with the family. And people often ask me why I do what I do. I say I do exactly what my parents and my community elders did. It never occurred to me not to do what I do. And they really did believe and try to live the fact that service is the rent we all pay for living. My father was a Baptist minister. And my mother was the entrepreneur in the family. She raised the money. She was a church organist. She started the Mother's Club. She started Circles of Women, which continues to this day. And they were real partners. My dad used to call her pal. But they were really a terrific partnership. I loved it, now that I look back, that they never made any distinction between their girls and their boys. Mm-hmm. We were five children. I'm the youngest accident at the end of four children who are much older than I am. But all the girls, the two of us always knew we were as smart as our brothers. The expectations were that we would get educated and that we would give back. And so we just had extraordinary role models. And after I left home, My mother took in 12 foster sisters and brothers and kept busy, and she continued to run a home for the aged. And what I loved about them is that they tried to live their faith daily, as did so many of my community elders. I would have been devastated if my parents hadn't been who I thought they were. And I loved being able to go with them as the last child in the family after all the other siblings had left, everywhere they went. So that, you know, I went to visit the sick and I went to do whatever had to be done. And I loved their childhood message that if you see problems in the world, you just don't ask why somebody doesn't do something, you do it. And I remember as a young child, they started a home for the aged because old Reverend Reddick, whom I now know had Alzheimer's disease, that we hadn't named it then, was wandering around the street and we didn't have black homes for the aged in my hometown. And so my mother and father began one across the street. And all of us children had to cook and clean, and we sure didn't like it, but that's how we learn that everybody's our neighbor and that we all have a responsibility when we see a need to respond to that. And my last thing I would simply say is that I think that I learned proactivity from them. Daddy used to ask us when we came home from school, had anybody assigned us any homework? Did the teacher give you any homework? And we said no. He said, well, assign yourself some. And now the bad side of that is that I am a workaholic, and my children, unfortunately, have inherited that from me. Yeah. But he would always ask, don't you have anything constructive to do, if he'd see us doing nothing or sitting or whatever. And we all learn, the right children, that the only time he would not give us a chore was when we were reading, so we all grew up to be great readers. But they were great parents, and I still try to. We talk about them, all five bright children who are together, we will talk about our parents in a nanosecond and what would Mama think or what would Daddy think. And we have a CDF office in the home I was born in, and that's where our Freedom School Curriculum Laboratory is, so they're still very much alive in all that we do.
Great. I want to talk about this report, and I don't know how many people have seen it, but this amazing report, America's Cradle to Prison Pipeline, that you put out. And the audience can't see it, but this very small Hispanic boy has to stand on a crate in order to be fingerprinted by a sheriff. As a graphic reminder that the children are getting younger and smaller, but they're being prosecuted for crimes to the same extent. What makes this happen, and why did you write this report to illustrate this problem?
Well, I wrote this report because I was devastated by the fact that I'd learned that Ms. Maybertha Carter, who was a great, great woman, she lived in the same county, Sunflower County, as Ms. Fannalou Hamer, and they were the plaintiffs in my last case in Mississippi to do away with that sham freedom of choice, because she wanted her seven younger children who were sharecroppers not to become sharecroppers. And to have a better life, and she knew that education was key to that, and so she asked if we would take her case, and we did, and we won this case, and we ended Freedom of Choice. Ms. Maybertha's seven children went to Sunflower County Schools, Drew, Mississippi Schools, and this was a terrible town. I mean, I didn't like to stay there after dark, and I'd wave and kiss Ms. Hayman and Ms. Carter bye and say, I'll see you in the morning, but the courage that it took for her to do this, each of those children went as the only child in their classroom to those Drew schools. They were harassed. They were just, it's unthinkable what they did. They withstood violence. They lost their jobs. They got pushed off their plantation. But every one of those Carter children graduated from high school and went on to Ole Miss or Mississippi State and became professionals. And about seven years ago, I got a call from a friend who said that Ms. Carter's grandson, Lorenzo, was in Parchment Prison. And we began to look at what was happening to the next generation of black children after all of this sacrifice and during the Civil Rights Movement. And black boys and Drew were all, you know, going under dead-end lives. They were all in the drug trade. There was nothing to do. There were no jobs. There was no hope. And you wanted to say, what could happen here? So we began to look generally at what was happening to black children in the post-desegregation era. And that led to this, because it turned out that the problems in Mississippi were national problems. And so you wanted to sound a loud siren of alarm to say, folk, you know, we're losing it, and we're going backwards in just one or two generations here. And this, in my belief, is that this is the worst crisis faced by the black community since slavery, and that incarceration is becoming the new American apartheid. We're feeding poor children by the hundreds of thousands each year into this pipeline to prison and to dead-end lives, at younger and younger ages. And we've got to stay and to redirect them to college and to productive work, but it's going to take an all-hands-on-deck approach. It's not been visible. But I tell you, once we did this report and saw how serious it is, and it's still driven, as you know, largely by poverty and racial disparities, which still permeate almost all of our child caring systems, we just have to sort of mobilize and say we've got to stop this because it's going to undo the last 50 years of progress. And it says that we adults, in my view, have abandoned our sense of responsibility to the next generations. Many of our black and white institutions that socialize children in childhood have, I think, dropped the ball of their responsibility. The role of parents and families have frayed. The role of communities has, you know, weakened. Mm-hmm. The role of congregations that were such important hubs in our lives. No, the church doors are closed most days. You know, the gangs are open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Absolutely.
And we're not competing. And so we really want to say, hey, let's look at this and let's begin to see it and name it and change it. It's not an act of God. It's a set of choices. And we adults need to find our voice and reclaim our children.
Thank you. Let me ask you one question. It's interesting. Many of us witnessed the effort by President Bush to create No Child Left Behind that had some good aspects of it and some not so good aspects of it. A lot of people don't know that before No Child Left Behind, you had a declarative statement. It said, leave no child behind. That was your
trademark mantra. Mission statement.
From the beginning. Think the president borrowed something from you?
That's a nice way of putting it, yes. But
difference between what the nation talks about, No Child Left Behind, which is no longer in effect, and your exclamation, leave no child behind? What's the point you're making?
Well, leave no child. I believe very deeply, and I'm a person of faith, that's the way I was raised, that every child is sacred and that every child's life is of equal value, and that America promises a level playing field for every child. We don't provide it. I mean, many of these babies are born with three or four or five strikes against them. They never, ever get on a track to successful adulthood. They are diverted at low birth weight, with a poor, single, teen mother, absent father, often substance abusing or has been domestically abused. And so they come on the earth with three, four, five strikes against them. And then those disadvantages and risks accumulate as they grow older. They don't have the strong early childhood development experiences that many of us who are privileged to have strong families have. Many of them are diverted into the child welfare system at the beginning, which again increases their chances of going into the juvenile and criminal adult system. We don't have strong home visitation programs. We've got examples of them, and we're going to try to put them in place nationally because we know what to do. The pipeline, again, I keep saying, is not an act of God. When you say poverty and racial disparities, people glaze over and say, oh, that's an intractable problem. It is something that we created it. We can dismantle it, and we can change this. But we don't have the early childhood systems in place, and so children in the first 3 years of life, when we know how important early brain development is, and Irvin Harris, and others made that so clear so long ago, but we don't put into place those things to stimulate children. There's a very scary study out in Kansas City by Hart and Riesley that looked at children of welfare mothers and children of more affluent parents and found that by age three, there was already a 30 million word interaction gap. I mean, you can't teach what you don't know. If your mother who's a dropout in school, you were not well-parented, you don't have a support system, well, we've got to break that cycle so that by age three, they're already lagging, and then we don't have a high-quality universal preschool system and high-quality child care, which we know how to provide, and we've got to make this country do it in the next year or two. And so they go to school not ready to learn, already behind at five, six, and then they go to schools that don't expect them to learn and don't support them in learning. And I just say that, you know, we need to hold ourselves accountable and hold our education system accountable, because our schools are not performing. A majority of all children in 4th, 8th, and 12th grade of all races are not able to read at grade level or compute at grade level. What are you going to do in this globalizing economy if you can't read and compute at grade level? You're being sentenced to dead-end lives. And over 80% of black and Latino children cannot read and compute at grade level. I mean, this is a disaster.
Is it worse now than it was during segregation?
Yeah, because we had the best teachers. We didn't have the brain drain, if you will. I mean, I don't want to say how wonderful segregated education was, but we had teachers who had very high expectations. We were not allowed to fail in my little school systems. We had bad books. We didn't have equal libraries. We didn't have equal pay for teachers in my earlier years. But those teachers knew that their job was to prepare us for the future, and that we were going to learn our tables. We were going to learn how to read. And we had this community buffer because while the external world told us we weren't important and couldn't succeed, our parents said it wasn't so, and we always had books in my home, even when we didn't have a second pair of shoes. Our teachers said it wasn't so, our preachers said it wasn't so, and so we knew it wasn't so. And so this strong emphasis on education as the way out and the means by which you would change the world, and we always were taught that we could change the world, and we had these role models everywhere. That's missing today for so many of our children, and so we are seeing schools actually with zero tolerance drug discipline policies carried over from the zero tolerance drug policies, suspending and expelling and actually arresting on school grounds 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old children for behaviors that used to be handled in the school office.
One of these pieces of data you have here, 17,000 public school students are suspended. Was one of the problems that you see as well.
Oh, the massive numbers of suspension. But I think adults have lost their common sense in their minds. You know, what are you doing bringing in 3 police officers in Florida to arrest a 7-year-old child who's had a...
5-year-old.
You were there.
This was just before Katrina. This was in 2005. Was in Tampa. And I saw this news story.
Can't make sense.
This 5-year-old girl who the teacher said was disruptive. And they call police, and they literally handcuff this girl, and you see her crying and screaming. And it's not just the outrage of what happened then, but think of the trauma for her life. That is that, you know, I'm worthless, and I can be contained, I can be restrained, I can be detained, and that has to be an impact. When we see her when she's 12 or 15 having problems, we won't really realize the connection goes back to what they failed to do when they saw a child looking out for needs 5 years old.
In fact, I saw the video. I was not there, but saw the video. They arrested her after the temper tantrum had ended.
Absolutely.
3 police officers before the mother could get to the school, and the terror in this child's eyes. I mean, it's unthinkable what we're doing here. And I think that, again, no community outcry, that this has changed these kinds of policies. But more importantly, they're not teaching our children to learn.
Right.
And I really am trying to encourage everybody to go into education. I've kept all 3 of my boys out of law school so far. We don't need more lawyers. We need teachers, but we need to get bad teachers out. If teachers and people in child-serving institutions don't love children, don't respect children, don't believe that they can achieve, because children will live up or down to our expectations, we've got to get them out of there. And that's why we've got to have very clear community voice for children, and that's missing too.
Sounds like you should be our Secretary of Education.
No, we've got a great Secretary of Education. We're going to push him from the outside with a new movement. That's why you and I are here.
True.
But he's going to do the job well.
Let me ask you this. It was more than a year ago. It was in early 2008 that you and I met in Washington, D.C., and I don't even know what political affiliation you are. I'm a Democrat. It's obvious about that.
But I'm a children's advocate.
Right, but that's the point I want to make. Because I said, you know, Marian, this is great. Either Hillary Clinton or Barack Obama may win, and now we'll have someone who will take care of the needs of children that you've been fighting for all these decades. You weren't persuaded that the Democrats were necessarily going to do something dramatically different than had been done in the past. Do we now have anything comprehensive in terms of addressing the needs of the children now that we have a Democrat in office?
Well, I think that this is a president who understands and gets these problems. I think that the stimulus package and the budget, which we've got to keep and sustain, is the best budget that the poor has ever had. Mm-hmm. Since I've been working on these issues. There's $1.5 billion in there for early Head Start. There's $1 billion in there for Head Start. There's another $1 billion or so in there for child care. There's an $8 billion investment in home visitation over the next years. And so if you look at all the pieces that have been put into place, we have the ingredients for putting into place an early childhood system. He's tried to give us the chance to invest in it. It's up to us to make sure that money is used well and innovatively to meet the needs of children and to break down all of our silos and our organizational needs and to really say, what do children need now? If you look at the education budget, I mean, Mr. Bush talked about being the education president, but he put a heck of a lot more money in tax cuts for millionaires and billionaires than he did in education. Well, aren't we not going to have some money now? And we can have a serious debate in his innovation fund and in the $100 billion that he's got to sort of put leverage on states to talk about national standards and to really begin to close that achievement gap and to really address teacher quality and teacher leadership and to hold them accountable. But that's, he's got both the carrot, but he's got a stick. And so I think the bottom line is that we've got good new tools to work with. We've got people who really really do understand about prevention. But, you know, there are no friends in politics. The president has got his lap full, his hands full. He's got a few wars to solve. He's got this debacle in the economy. He's got global warming, and, you know, it's unthinkable. And if children are going to stay central to the decision-making of the administration and to the Congress, citizens on the outside are going to have to build a loud movement. It's, you know, we're struggling here now for health and mental health coverage. Mm-hmm. How do we keep children at the table as we talk about reform when there's this great pressure to get a national health reform program, but can we do it right for children? Can we not have them sort of symbolically there, but leaving a lot of them out of the healthcare safety net? So it's going to be very hard. I mean, I often tell the story that I heard about A. Philip Randolph going to the White House to tell the President Roosevelt about how bad things were for the black community and how we needed to do something about employment and education and all the rest, and the president listened very thoughtfully. And then he said, after he'd heard it, "Phil, I agree with everything you said. Now you've got to go out and make me do it." And so we've got to go out and make them do what they want to do, but where they have so many competing, powerful, and loud interests, if we don't make a lot of noise, we're not going to realize this extraordinary harvest time. So we've got an opportunity, but we've got a lot of work to do.
And who's the we? Because the reality is that children don't have any power. They don't vote, right? They aren't taxpayers. They don't have the political force. Who are the we you're talking to, both in this audience here and the audience listening? That what should people do on a local level as opposed to waiting for the president or Congress to do something? What can we do? Write letters, have meetings. What are the concrete things you think need to be done?
Well, we is parents and families. We are people of faith and religious congregations. We are our school people, our people who care about the education and health of our children. Now, one of the problems is that, you know, many people who are considered to be children's advocates are really providers, and we often get confusion between the job security for adults and what children need. And so children really don't have, there's no single constituency for children. It turns out to be very complicated. And people who are in child care don't actually talk to people who are worried about juvenile justice or who are worried about health care. So you've got these fragmented constituents for this constituentless group of people, this voiceless group of people. But I think that, you know, the faith community needs to find its voice and remember what it's supposed to do for the orphan and for the marginalized and for the poor. I think that parents and community leaders and civil rights leaders and need to find their voice and understand. The business community needs to get up here and realize that this is its future workforce as well as its future consumers. Mm-hmm. And so it's the right thing to do for children because that is what we're all supposed to do. But it is also the self-interested thing for all of us to invest in our children. Because
what about the whispering campaign? Here's one of the things that, at least a controversial element of what you're talking about. Now, again, this is a picture of a young Hispanic boy being fingerprinted. That's criminal. It's not a picture of someone who's hungry or homeless or undereducated. And so you're saying that when we talk about children, you want to embrace them all. How do you get that suburban family to say, you know, this kid has been arrested, this kid is truant? Why are you taking everyone in as opposed to the safer cases where there's not a criminal justice, juvenile justice connection? Why are they all included?
Again, I think we start back at our basic premise as, you know, Judeo-Christian, Muslim, all great faiths say children are sacred. Either you believe they are or they're not. Right. Either you believe that children's lives are all equal or they're not. And so you start from a moral point of view, and then you move to a self-interest point of view, because you got to walk the street with these children. Right. I don't want to be supporting all these children in prison when they ought to be out working and supporting us, as we, you know, worry about how we're going to sustain our Social Security and Medicare system. Third, it's better to invest up front than to invest more. And as a result of our neglect. I mean, every dollar you spend to immunize a child is going to save $16. Every child you give preventive and primary health care means you're not going to have billions in hospitalization costs. I mean, every child you don't have drop out of school means you're going to have the chance to have a productive worker who's going to make a stronger economy. And so you make the self-interest argument. Our states at the moment are spending, on average, 3 times more per prisoner than per public school pupil. That's about the dumbest investment policy I can think of. And so we lay out the savings of prevention. So you may not like these children, but it is in your self-interest to invest in making them productive workers and people who are valued so that they will value and work for the broader community. And so it's also going to be critical to making sure that this nation is able to compete in the new globalizing world in the 21st century. I mean, look at us. And I brought one little chart. I give too many figures often. But we've got to reorder our priorities, or we're not going to be world leaders in, you know, the Chinese and the Europeans and the Indians and the Brazilians are doing such better work. And you know, our country loves to be number one in everything. But we are number one in GDP, we're number one in millionaires and billionaires, and we're one in military expenditures and exports. And somehow then we go and we're 16th in maternal mortality rates. We're 21st in our 15-year-old science scores. We're 22nd in low birth weight, 23rd in neonatal mortality rates. We're 25th in our 15-year-old math scores, and this is among all the OECD countries that are industrialized nations, most all of whom are less wealthy than we are. We're 27th in infant mortality. We lose 28,000 babies every year. And we're last in relative child poverty. We're last in the gap between rich and poor. We're last in teen birth rates. We're last in protecting our children against gun violence. And we're worse in the number of people who are incarcerated. And if we compare black child well-being, just black child well-being, these are all children, 62 nations have lower infant mortality rates, including Barbados, Malaysia, and Thailand. Over 100 nations have lower percentages of low birth weight babies, including Algeria and Botswana and Panama. And black women in the United States are more likely to die from maternal mortality than women in Turkmenistan. But these numbers are going to kill us. I mean, you know, these 350,000 low birth weight babies that feed into this cradle to prison pipeline, you know, they cost 25 times more in hospitalization cost than normal birth weight babies. You know, we've got to reorder ourselves. If we're going to contain health care costs, then we've got to make sure that every child gets born healthy and hopefully at normal birth weight, and every child gets what they need to be able to see the teacher and the blackboard and to have their attention deficit disorder. We worry about dropout rates, but, you know, if you can't see, you can't hear, you got mental problems that are not dealt with, you're not going to have children learning in school. And so self-interest as well as common decency, I think, propels us to do better. And we can do better, but we need to reset our moral and economic compass.
Great. We have two microphones, one on each side of the room. We'll be taking questions in just a moment. Let me ask you this. The whole nation, indeed the world, was horrified in August 2005 when we witnessed the devastation caused by Katrina, not just in New Orleans, particularly New Orleans, but in Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, and Florida were all impacted one way or the other. And once CNN left and ABC News left and the levels went down, everyone thought, okay, now we're rebuilding, it's fine. But there was a tragic loss in Katrina and New Orleans that people didn't know about, but you spoke up about that. What happened that people completely forgot about with those, the separations after August 2005?
We forgot about our children. Children always kind of get lost in all of this. And I tell you, we're just about to issue a new report on the eve of the fourth anniversary of Katrina's, and we've left our children behind. They're still living, they're so fragile, they're living in a purgatory. The housing and homelessness is widespread. I just talked to my New Orleans, our Louisiana office this morning, and they just talked about the homelessness and the housing situation. There's still thousands sitting there in those unsafe formaldehyde-infected trailers, but FEMA has extended time for them, but it's still, they need to get out of there before hurricane season, but they're unhealthy environments for anybody to be in. They talked about the number of children who are still having these post-traumatic stress syndrome problems, and our health and mental health systems, already inadequate in Louisiana and across the country, are now worse. And they gave an example. We're running 50 freedom schools down there this summer just to give children some alternatives to the streets.
50 freedom schools.
We have 50 freedom schools, and we have an all-year-round freedom school. And Mary Joseph, our director, was just telling me about a problem we had yesterday morning with an 11-year-old who was suicidal, was having terrible dreams about killing himself. We have an emergency medical van that we also, that UNICEF contributed to us to use down there. But she was just talking about how horribly difficult the mental health problems still are and how much of a struggle it is to get mental health services in the systems that have never been rebuilt. And yesterday, she said, they'd spent the day lobbying to keep the governor from closing, and they lost the mental health hospital for children in New Orleans. And so the closest mental health system place that they can go is 40 miles away, and for parents who don't have transportation. So the mental health needs are overwhelming. The health needs are overwhelming. She talked about the children who are still not reconnected with their families, and they estimate that there are 5,000 or more of children who have not yet been reunified
with
their families.
Children who were separated in August 2005 are still not connected with their families?
Not reunified with their families. In fact, this child's mother lives out of state, and that loss, I mean, these children are dealing with unthinkable losses. And so his mother is not present, and he has not ever gotten back to the family that he had pre-Katrina. And obviously that is feeding into everything. And she also talked about the number of homeless teenagers who are living by themselves. But, you know, there's this unthinkable loss. And I was just so moved when you talk to these children. They say they need hope. Tell them we need hope, and we are not providing that hope. The child care establishment has been destroyed in New Orleans. It's not been rebuilt. Less than a third of the child care centers that were there have been replaced, and parents who need to work don't have a place to leave their children. And so it's just disgraceful that in the richest, most powerful nation on earth, you've got thousands and thousands of children still at bay, without adequate health and mental health services, without a health system that we're trying to correct this year. Because if we had a national health safety net, the children who moved all over the country after Katrina, who didn't qualify for the different state rules on health care, could have gotten that need. And we still haven't done that. We still don't have an adequate disaster policy so that when these things happen, wherever they go, they will have certain guarantees to health, housing, and basic needs. And so these children of Katrina need not be forgotten, and we need to put into place the kinds of systems that will stop us from neglecting and writing off children. And these are the candidates for the Cradle to Prison pipeline. The gangs are all back, the violence is all back, and they also talked about how pervasive now substance abuse and alcoholism and domestic violence as a result of kind of the total uncertainty and the just being at bay. We can do better. I mean, so Katrina's children we should keep in our minds as a symbol of our failure to put into place the kinds of systems that we must have, that most other industrialized countries have, that can give children a chance to reach successful adulthood.
I want to say two things. I spoke at your conference in September 2007.
You were wonderful.
Well, thank you. But this report is on your website, which is?
www.childrensdefense.org, and I have a sign-up sheet out back, anybody who wants it. And anybody who wants the video who's going to have discussion groups in their communities and congregations to say what can we do, because we can do a lot. We need your voices to sign up to say, hey, we got to have health and mental health coverage this year. Next year, we got to have quality education. So we can get it outside, and you can also, if you sign up, we'll make sure that you get it. And we have a list of things that everybody can do, from mentoring to being a CASA volunteer, as some people in the audience are. But there's so many ways we can help, one-on-one, reaching out to the child. And there's so many ways as voters and as people of influence we can make it heard. But you got to have children's needs taken care of first, not last.
We also have a link to this report on our website, www.charleshamiltonhouston.org, because of the conference. And we also just issued a report based on what we learned from this. We didn't quite steal your title, but our report said No More Children Left Behind Bars, to talk about the fact that we are in placing more children and profiled as gangs. If we had prevention and treatment, they would not be suspended from school, expelled from school. They could be productive citizens. And that report helped Bobby Scott introduce the Youth Promise Act, which now has almost 300 sponsors, which I hope will be.
20. He's getting there.
Yeah, so things are happening. I wanted to end, before we go to the questions of the audience, with I have 1,000 times used this book in my speeches,
Thank you.
The Measure of Our Success. And if you get this book, it's still available. It's remarkable, particularly what's called Part 4. It's 25 Lessons for Life. It's sort of a meditation to your sons, right? And it's a pretty tough thing when you start reading it. If you're a teenager, said, okay, Mom, what are you telling me? She said, well, one, there is no free lunch. Never work just for money or for power. They won't save your soul or help you sleep at night. Take parenting and family life seriously and insist that those who work for you and who represent you do. Remember that your wife is not your mother or your maid, but your partner and friend. And it gets even stronger after that. And these are two, I mean, a public book about my sons. I want you to know, I'm telling you, but I'm telling the world what you need to do. And this new book, the title tells you everything. The sea is so wide and my boat is so small. What could be clearer? The sea is so wide and my boat is so small. Talking about the challenges that children have, and Dr. Edelman writes, charting a course for the next generation. Everything about this book I love, but I just wanted to read this prayer for 21st century children, which is pretty remarkable. God, help us to not raise a new generation of children with high intellectual quotients and low caring and compassion quotients, with sharp competitive edges but dull cooperative instincts, with highly developed computer skills but poorly developed consciences, with a gigantic commitment to the big I but little sense of responsibility to the bigger we, with mounds of disconnected and unsynthesized information without a moral context to determine its worth, with more and more knowledge and less imagination and appreciation for the magic of life that cannot be quantified or computerized, with more and more worldliness and less wonder and awe for the sacred and everyday miracles of life. God, help us raise children who care. You have been preaching this message for a very long time, and it is clearly making a big difference in the lives of so many others. And I want to publicly, as this audience will join me, in thanking Dr. Marian Wright Edelman for her remarkable work. We have time for a few audience questions. There's a microphone to the left and one to the right. We'll start on the left and then come back to the right. Yes.
Thank you. I'm James Calloway from the great nation of Texas over here.
There you go.
Yes, I spent a great deal of time working on the issues that you're speaking about in Houston. And one of the things that is very difficult is that there seems to be no established standard of care for care and education for young children across the nation that we all say not only do we agree that this is some basic standard of care, but that we actually fund it. And, you know, one of the things I'm so frustrated about is we know, for instance, that early good Head Start programs, high-intensity, full-day child Head Start programs have a great effect on the long-term care of children. But in my city, in our state, we get block grants that come down from Washington that by the time they get to my city, it only cares for 10% of the children who qualify under the economic guidelines. And I've always wondered, how did we get into a moral condition where we say, well, if you happen to be the 10.1% child that happens to not get in line, well, you're out of luck, even though we know this is going to have a profound effect on your whole life. So there seems to be a hodgepodge of funding, inadequate standards, And I don't understand how we get to a moral position that makes any sense with that program and many others that relate to children. So could you speak to that a little bit?
Well, I could not agree with you more. We wrote the perfect child development bill in 1971. It was called the Comprehensive Child Development Act of 1971, built a broad coalition, got it through, was redrafted it. President Wilson vetoed it on his way to China and said we were communalizing American family life. It took us 20 years later to get the child care block grant, which the first President Bush signed, and it was that block grant that still does not reach everybody, but it has helped millions and didn't have any standards and left it up to the states. And we've tried to improve it ever since, and we've got this patchwork of programs that are subject to the unjust lottery of 50 states in health care and almost all of our children's areas, and that's a part of what we've got to change. All children should be given their basic survival needs. I mean, all of us senior citizens have Medicare. Why should our children have less of a health safety net than senior citizens? And so this year in the health care debate, we're trying to say all children should have a minimum eligibility standard of 300%, and they're all guaranteed child-appropriate Medicaid kind of benefits that are comprehensive, that include mental health, and that it should be simple and easy because God did not make two classes of children. And that is our debate this year. Can we have a national standard rather than continue to fight Texas that is as fast as we can get there, they cut back on people, and the business community has gotten involved with health care, and still your governor didn't get through the reforms we wanted in the Texas legislature. We cannot fight these 50-state battles, and there should not be this 50-state valuation of a child's chance to survive, learn. And so I think that we're on the cusp, though, of a major opportunity. Can we come this year in the healthcare debate and begin to make sure that wherever a child lives, they will be guaranteed health and mental health services, and that we will make the bureaucracy simple? Right now it's so hard. 6 of the 9 million uninsured children are currently eligible for Medicaid or CHIP. They can't get it because of state bureaucracies. Need to change it. I think we now, with the money that's put into the budgets, into the recovery package, and within the education thing, have a chance to talk about high quality early childhood education that fits the child and the family's needs. And this is the year to have that debate and to talk about national standards, whether you take the Head Start standards and apply them to all early childhood standards. We used to have daycare national standards, but this is the year to have those debates this and next year. And we need to sit down and make sure that the child care people talk to the Head Start people, talk to the preschool people, talk to the after school people, and make sure that we talk about what children need. We've got to get out of our silos and our organizational self-interest and build that system. And with Arne Duncan and the new education investments, I think we're having a real debate forthcoming about national education standards, so that you don't have this mishmash of things, and the fact that they are moving toward national standards, but with some money behind it, gives us a chance, I think, to really begin to fix this very inadequate, unjust, underfunded system that allows our children to get what they need to succeed in getting ready for school and getting through school and graduating and then going to college and graduating. We need to pay a lot of attention to college retention, right, and not just to college entrance. But this is the hope of the next few years, and I just hope we do not blow it, that we'll get ourselves together and that we'll build that constituency of seeing that all children get what they need to succeed in this very wealthy nation.
And the poster child is not just black or brown male. I mean, this affects every child throughout the country, boys and girls, black, white, brown. And that's part of it. The idea is that, well, those are kids from families where the mothers allowed themselves to be abused, where the fathers were drug addicts, people in prison. Excuses not to address the problems, but the problem is massive and broad.
The problem is massive. The Children's Defense Fund speaks for all children. Yeah. And while I give these terrible figures and I say that a child drops out of school every 10 days or every 10 seconds of the school day, or, you know, is born into poverty or has not got health care, these are white, black, all children. There are more poor white children than there are poor black children or brown children. Drug problems, teenage pregnancy problems, all of these are universal problems. Domestic violence, child abuse, cut across race and class. And while black and brown children may be disproportionately affected, these are all of our problems. And I worry a lot about the spiritual problems of affluenza. I mean, all of our wealthy children who are astray and who have drug problems and violence problems, mental health problems, these are universal problems, and we need to rebuild families at all levels, and we need to rebuild the moral fabric of our society so that our children can succeed. So this is not other people's children, it's our children too.
Great. The next question, yes.
Hi, I'm Laura Lauder from San Francisco, and I'm a Shiro. You are my Shiro as well, Marian, so thanks for all you do. My question is about some successful models. One in particular that I've seen is the Harlem Children's Zone in New York, and I'm wondering if you can specifically describe some of the successes of the Harlem Children's Zone and what lessons we've learned and how scalable that model is.
There are lots of wonderful people doing wonderful things. There are lots of wonderful models out there. We need to scale them up, sustain them, fund them adequately, and the Harlem Children's Zone is one of those. And as you may know, in fact, Jeff was at the White House yesterday with the White House meeting on social innovations, and it's a geographic place-based place. He's taken a 97-block area in Harlem and tried to put into place the continuum of services, starting with baby college, which is my favorite, through early childhood and through the school years with after-school programs, and he's showing that you can have successes and that when you really give that full continuum of comprehensive services, engage parents and the whole community, that you can get good outcomes. And so, you know, the president has proposed 20 additional promise zones. I think replication is never so easy. There are not many Jeff Canadas around, and you don't have many boards that have billionaires like Stan Druckenmiller, but we've got to figure out in its own way what other kinds of organic Harlem children's zones we can build in local communities. But the point of providing a continuum of high quality, comprehensive services from before birth or from birth through entrance into college is really a model that ought to be followed. But there are many, many things out there that are working. And in this book, we talk about a variety of best practices. We know what to do. to get children to successful adulthood and through college and into productive work. We just need to do it. But that's going to require thoughtful public policies, and that's both the promise and the challenge of the next 4 to 8 years.
Indeed. Let me say this, too, that about Jeffrey Kennedy, who's a great guy. The sea is so wide and my boat is so small. That's the reaction that I fear that too many people in too many states will have. We can't replicate what Jeff does.
Yes, you can.
But you can.
You can.
It doesn't have to cost the same amount. The other thing that Marian didn't mention, what makes Jeff Kennedy's program so impressive to me, it's about the children, but it's about the family. These parents have never had parenting skills. They're being taught things that they never learned in school. Many of them are high school dropouts. And in fact, they're learning things that will help their children. Because we still now expect these parents who didn't get a very good education, who were taught the old math, to try to teach their children the new math. And they can't. It's a failed system. But I think that's one of the amazing things to think about, how to use it in a constructive way. And the most important lesson from Jeffrey Kennedy, from my point of view, it doesn't matter where you are, you can address the problem locally. He didn't take these kids
That's
to Westchester.
Right. That's right.
He said, they're from Harlem. We're going to make it happen in Harlem. If you make a commitment, you can do it there. It makes an enormous amount of difference.
And I think it's wonderful they're going to replicate. I hope we need not 20, we need 2,000. But
exactly.
I think the point is that we need to put down our buckets where we are. If we could get every black church or every church, we've got 345,000 religious congregations to say, we're going to take responsibility for children within a five-block radius of our community, and we're going to open up these doors and have freedom schools, which you're going to see before we end. You know, we could make an enormous impact. So we have the means at hand. And I just, Jeff Canada happens to be our new incoming board chair. He's our vice chair, and he's one of the kind of extraordinary young leaders across the country that are out there, and I now hope that they will find their voices in this new era.
In terms of history, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton started with you more than 30 years ago.
Well, she did, and look at where she's gone. And I find
keep that in mind.
Right? Law student, she came as a law student, and I loved her because she would do whatever needed to be done. She knocked on doors and found children out of school. She would go out to migrant camps, and you know, I just am so pleased to watch this new generation find their voice. And one of the things that's great fun right now is seeing this enormous transfer of power from the Moses, Miriam, to the Joshua, Deborah generation. And every time you go over now to visit anybody in this administration, out pops these heads saying, hello there, and then you find there were kids in your playgroup who were running the country.
Yep.
And it's really quite extraordinary, this new energy and the new talent. So this is a hopeful and challenging time.
Absolutely. Next question, Professor Carter. Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. You both talked about high school dropout rates, and I was wondering if you could provide a bit more information. I know that in certain major urban centers, less than 40% of black boys graduate from high school, for instance, which is always a shocking statistic. So if you could provide just a bit of that, and also how high school dropouts correlate with incarceration.
I'll say a word. The report I mentioned before, No More Children Left Behind Bars, we document that. And we, if you go to charleshamiltonhouston.org website, you'll see how it has an impact for this reason. And the numbers are higher than that. The deceptiveness of the numbers is this, that when all of these kids drop out in ninth grade, then they look at the number of people who are left in 10th grade, and that doesn't reflect those who started in the ninth grade and those who finish in the 12th grade. It's bigger than 40%. That's one of the problems. We've done analysis looking at data showing how much of a difference in savings we would make as a country if a child finishes high school, the incredible amount of benefit that provides for them and for the country. Their labor and employment abilities are exponentially improved, and they're decreased as when they drop out of high school so early. And the reality is this, there's another problem that Marian Wright Edelman touched upon, the whole idea of the fourth grade, eighth grade, and 10th grade state mandatory tests that you must pass in order to get a high school diploma. More and more kids are dropping out because they're saying, you know, if I can't pass in the fourth grade or eighth grade, why wait around to be disappointed 4 years later? Let me try to find a job. And the jobs that they have now, they will be functionally incapable of carrying those jobs forward when they're 18, 19 years old.
Oh, it's It's an enormous problem. But again, there are schools that are making a difference.
Absolutely.
There are programs out there that are making a difference. And we all know about the KIPS and the new teacher projects and all the new innovations that are going on in schools. And we just need to have that public school competition. And I know that that's going to be reflected as we go forward in the authorization, mere authorization of a new No Child Left Behind Act is going to have a new name, thank goodness, though they've ruined our old name.
Right.
but it's going to have a new name. And so here's our chance to begin to kind of build on and with charters and performance schools, and we need that competition, and we also need to get the community to begin to hold the public schools accountable.
Right.
And we do have not enough examples of whole school systems that are doing a good job, but we highlight Wake County, Raleigh, North Carolina as one school system where with educational leadership and setting high expectations, they have managed to lift the whole floor where their children are not only graduating but are scoring well. And so we know how to do it. We just need leadership, and we need the push and the political will to demand this for all of our children. But we have great examples of how we can begin to turn this around. But the relationship between dropouts and the prison pipeline are enormous.
Absolutely.
One in three black boys going to prison in their lifetime risk. One in six Latino boys. I mean, we've just got to stop this. And so much of it is related to people who cannot read and write and don't have a means to make a decent living in this rich nation. So the schools are central.
Let me say something else that we haven't mentioned specifically. I've had the great honor of visiting Haley Forum. This is Marian Wright Edelman's really signature program where you see hundreds of students of color there. And what struck me the most surprising thing, going into Knoxville, Tennessee, and just seeing these energetic young people as leaders talking about education, you had a lot of black boys there. I mean, the reality is that black boys have disappeared from the radar in terms of educational pursuit. I was just so overwhelmed to see these black boys have their life resuscitated, and now they're important leaders in the program as well.
We're so committed to training a new generation of young leaders, of new generations of JEP Canadas, and we've been trying to create structures for advocacy. Haley Farm is our movement building school, and every year we train 1,200 black and Latino college students, and they're out right now running 145 freedom schools, summer rich enrichment learning programs, teaching children conflict resolution, but trying to teach them a love of learning. And 39% of those who came this year were black males. Children don't need Michael Jordan as a role model. They need somebody who grew up three blocks away from them, went through the same problems, know how to be there as a role model, help these kids through, show them what they can become. And so it's working. And we have 19 freedom schools in Kansas City, and we've just had our first 3-year national evaluation by Philip Associates. And if you come to freedom schools for 6 weeks in the summer for 3 years in Kansas City, you're likely to pick up 2.2 years of reading gains. And we're doing best among middle school poor children. But the college students are fantastic, and the energy and the excitement and the high expectations and a very strong curriculum make it all work. And you're going to see at the end here the hopeful sign of what can happen if we choose to make sure that children get what they need and are with safe mentors and have safe havens from the street. And while we need to correct schools and we need to address poverty, and every year we leave 13 million children in poverty, cost us all $500 billion in lost productivity, we also need to make sure that children are having good things to do after school and in the summer. Again, they need to be with caring adults, and we've got wonderful models, and one of the models I want you to see as we end is with these freedom schools, and I hope we can have, because children are in school only 17% of their day, and so we've got to find something to do for the rest of that time, and we think the freedom schools are one such model, and we're trying to begin them all over the country, but they're run by these college students and by community institutions, but they're also a means to reintegrate and re-engage the community with its children. And so they're in churches, and they're in schools, and they're in community centers, but they need to be everywhere, and we're trying to form relationships with colleges. Davidson College runs one. We've got historically black colleges running them, and one of my goals is to see that every black college has a freedom school to build that bridge between college and community so that children can see that prison isn't the only thing in their future, college can be in their future. So we think it's one of those models that can work, and we hope you'll all try to get a freedom school so in your own communities.
Let me ask a question before I take these last two questions and we end, and that is the hypothetical 60-year-old person who lives in Westchester who's going to be retiring soon. They can write you a check, but what can they do in Westchester to help the Children's Defense Fund. How do you get this audience listening and here to connect with what you want to do? What constructively can and should they be doing?
Well, I just hope, one, that they, we 60-year-olds, we vote. And people listen to us. And so we need to vote for our grandchildren. We need to call up. We have an annual voting record, which we'll release in about a month. Look at it. All of these folk who say they love children and kiss them in their community get behind closed budget doors and vote against them. Mm-hmm. And so you really need to know whether your person is a 0 or a 20 or a 50, and really speak up for them. We need everybody to call their congressman and senator right now about health coverage for all children. And we got to do it right for children. And we this is the first entry point into the pipeline. So being that voice and getting on the phone and speaking to your congressman, not only for your own self-interest, but for children's important. This is the most well-educated group of seniors ever. I mean, they can all be there in mentoring and volunteering in the court system to help speak up for children who don't often have the best legal counsel. My board member, Dee Dee Eisenberg, is here. She's a CASA volunteer. But there are wonderful volunteer opportunities, and again, they're on the website and things that you can do. We need to get our congregations to wake up, and we've got models that can work, and I hope you can take some of these models and see how you can begin to put together the coalitions in your local communities with the time that you have to sort of get them off the ground. And we have my favorite program is what I call Beat the Odds, because we've got to change the image of who these children are. I'm so sick of the media always talking about the kids who kill somebody or who are on drugs. Most children are struggling to do the best they can, and they just need one person to be there as a counselor, as a mentor, as they don't have lifelines of hope. They don't have people who say you're important. And those of us with time can begin to volunteer to do that through Boys and Girls Clubs and through other kinds of ways, and we can help you hook up in your communities. But we celebrate in about 5 or 6 cities, and I'd love to have it in 200 cities, young people who are high school juniors and seniors who are beating the odds despite homelessness, domestic violence, no parents, incarcerated parents. And I tell you, one teacher, one counselor, one grandma, one person down the street, neighbor who took an interest, can turn these children's lives around. And I'm so pleased that we've got 700 young people in that pool now over the last 15 years who have gotten scholarships to go to college. And they are knockouts. They are doctors and lawyers and Peace Corps volunteers. And the point is, you have no right to give up on any child. And they are so hungry for adult lifelines of caring, which is why reweaving community, and even if you look like you're in a suburban church, I love it in Charlotte, North Carolina, that mainline churches are pairing up with inner city churches to run Freedom School, so we need to partner. We've got so many things that you can do. We can tell you, get on the website, get these suggestions, and then find one place where you think you can give your talents, because so many children are lonely and alone and just need one person, and then they need one strong voice. And so I just hope that we can engage you one-on-one, but we can engage you in building a strong voice for justice in the public policy arena, because children don't have any other voices than yours.
Question here, then finally, Professor Archer.
Marian, Elliot Gerson from the Aspen Institute, and I just want to tell you what a privilege and an inspiration it is for you to be here with us. I have a question specifically related to the prison pipeline. A number of people here heard your friend and associate Bernadine Doran speak about the specific issues relating to juvenile justice. Every year, this country tries, sentences, or incarcerates 200,000 children as adults. We have sentenced, despite the unconstitutionality of the death penalty to children, we have sentenced 2,500 children to die in prison. What is it about the United States that leads us to treat so many children as adults in the juvenile justice system?
Well, it's such a wrong-headed problem. It is. But what is it in the United States that allows us to let children be our poorest group of citizens, and nobody else does that? What allows us to deny millions of children health care when saving these children and getting them a chance to succeed also will save huge amounts of taxpayer money? What allows us to let the majority of our children not get an education in this globalizing arena? I mean, what allows us to have a juvenile justice system that is so unjust, that is just feeding children to the criminal justice system? Some of it's all wrapped up with race and with class, with our inability to sort of see all children as sacred and equal and of equal value. We make a distinction between our children and other people's children, not understanding that none of us are safe from the violence that other people's children may impose on our own. What it is about it to let these media signals and treating children as consumers send all this filth to our children? When we were growing up, we didn't have to compete with all these messages that glamorize violence and glamorize irresponsible sex and that glamorize consumerism. And so I think we've got a very deep issue here to confront about who we are and what we value and whether we're going to honor the things that America promises to honor. And in many sense, children, as Taylor Branch, who's done such chronicling of the civil rights movement, he says, are the ultimate test of the vibrancy of our democracy. And if we lose our children and if we continue to waste and throw them away and to treat them inequitably in all of our systems, including prosecuting them as adults, we're going to lose not only our soul, we're going to lose our leadership role. And so I think this is the ultimate test of who we are as a people, and I think we need to come to grips with that. No other country lets gun violence run amok and lets children be killed every 3 hours by guns. I don't know, what is it going to take for us to stand up and say we're going to stop the killing of children? Where is the faith community's voice? Where is the parental voice? I mean, I just think that we really do have to come to grips with who we are as a people and what we value and what kind of values we're going to pass on to the next generation and how we're going to be perceived in this 21st century world. I mean, I think that we've been given a new chance with this new extraordinary president to sort of say that we have something relevant for the whole world that is two-thirds non-white and two-thirds poor. But if we can't make democracy work for our own children and make capitalism fair to all of our own children, then we're not going to be credible. So I think that this is the ultimate test of our success, and it's our moral and economic Achilles heel. And so that juvenile justice problem that you describe and the treatment of children as adults is just one symptom of our failure to come to grips with the sacredness and the equal value of every child's life. And that is the problem in the world, and if we could somehow make America come to grips with it, then perhaps we may begin to have some new values in the new world. Dr. King warned us over and over and over again about the dangers of excessive materialism, of militarism, of racism, and of poverty, and we celebrate him, and we're going to build a new thing in the mall for him, and I'm sure he'd be proud and surprised, but we need to follow him. And we need to come to basic grips about how we're going to honor America's promise. And we haven't done that yet for millions and millions of our citizens and our children of the canaries in the mine. And we need to hear it.
I would just say before we go to Professor Archer that I think it's the twin evils of fear and ignorance. The image of crime is a young kid with baggy pants and a hat on. And it's the ignorance to think that we can punish somebody at 14 and sentence them to die, to death. The Supreme Court has accepted two cases on the issue of whether or not a juvenile sentenced to life without the possibility of parole, whether that's a cruel and unusual form of punishment. I think it is. The question is whether this court will think it is. And I think just like it took us decades to get the court to stop executing children, it's going to take a lot of effort, and Bernadine Dorn's one of the great experts on this, to make sure, and Jenny Sloan from the Constitution Project, doing incredible work to talk about children and make sure that the court can see them in a way that they haven't been seen before. That's very important.
And we're going to have a major paradigm shift away from punishment as a first resort to prevention and early intervention and toward investment. And most of the children who are in trouble are not there for violent offenses. Most of the people who are in prison are not there for violent offenses, they're for nonviolent offenses, and we've got to find a way of dealing with them in new ways.
And some of them are there, what I would even call offenses, when you talk about truancy
right.
and
precisely.
Things like
status
that,
offenses.
Just because they're children.
That's right.
Status offenses.
That's right.
Too many. Professor Archer?
Hi, Deborah Archer from New York. There has been some mention of No Child Left Behind and standards across the country. No Child Left Behind was supposed to help improve standards across the country, but I think it's contributed to the pipeline that you're speaking of by increasing dropouts and pushouts and closing schools in predominantly minority communities. As we're looking now to developing the new No Child Left Behind, I'd be interested in hearing what you think were the successes and failures of No Child Left Behind, and specifically what should be included now to ensure that we're holding schools and teachers accountable and increasing standards for all children.
Well, I like the fact that No Child says we need to have high expectations for all children. I like the fact that they disaggregate data by race so that we can see which groups of children are doing well and which not. And I I think that we should have accountability, and we need to think about those accountability measures. We need to really have now a very robust debate about what we want to do going forward. I think that there's been an overemphasis on narrow testing. Children are more than their tests, and we need to think about the kinds of assessment standards that we want to see put into place. I think we need to talk about how we set up some common standards across every state, and I hope that we will then actually put the money that is needed into improving teacher quality and school leadership, which are going to be the key components for making children succeed. I think everything should be on the table. I think that, and I'm having the best time, I'm not going to say, here are the 10 things the CDF wants to see done. We need to look at the Title I formula very carefully, because I think it does discriminate against the poorest children in the cities and against rural children, and so I think we need to look at it all and then figure out how we can make this thing going forward make sense, building on what works and doing away with what does not work. And we're in very thoughtful discussion now with all of our friends from the innovative school networks, as well as with school superintendents and others. And then with, we didn't have a lot of debate before No Child went through, and the community and parents didn't have a chance to have their voice. And I think that this is a time now, and Arne Duncan is doing his listening tours, and he's reaching out very fully. And I hope that a part of what goes on as we move forward is that we're going to see a relook at schools as community institutions. And, here we've got a chance to really co-locate services, to talk about longer school days and school weeks, so that children are there with caring folk. But I think that this is a real chance going forward to address the issues of teacher quality and accountability, and to make sure that high expectations are there with the supports and with the clearly articulated standards that are not dependent on each state, to really hope we'll be in a new place in 4 or 5 or 10 years. So,
let me just say that, Professor Archer, thank you for the work you've done at New York Law School on this very topic. I would just say this. There's a real risk that we'll miss the focus in the new No Child Left Behind if we don't think about it critically. And there are 3 or 4 things that I think are important. The first is that we have to say in this new legislation that to confine a child has to be the last, not the first alternative, the absolute last alternative, because we have to think of all the other ways we can address it. Second, we have to talk not just to superintendents, because there are some good ones, but they have a conflicted, or I could say a complicated role, because they do better when they have fewer problem children in the system, right? Your numbers look better, your performance looks better if you can get rid of the problems. That's not a way to think about education. You've got to educate everybody, not just those who fit the standard model. I just talked to Frieda Gail Stern, who's here, and I was talking just yesterday about the fact that too many libraries are being closed, right? And to think about, I know I wouldn't be here if there was no library, no place with books. Books make people, it's an equalizer. And the idea that you think about public institutions that are available and accessible, not everyone's going to have an internet or a computer, but a public library where you can learn and grow and experience is important. And those little details become quite significant when we think about how we address the problem of No Child Left Behind. And so it means that we can't talk about a remedy for children without hearing the voices of children, which is very critical. And I hope that this president, someone whose father was absent for most of his life, whose mother was pregnant as a teenager, who lived, as we know, around the world, not just around the neighborhood, and yet look where he is today. Somebody had a sense of faith and a sense of hope for him that made him what he is today, and that requires us to do the very thing as well.
I would just say to Professor Archer, thank you, too, but the other thing where I think we have a great opportunity is the OCR, the Office of Civil Rights Survey.
Yes.
And that has been, they didn't issue it last year, but I think that we've now got a chance to rewrite it and to make sure that we are able to track special education placement, school discipline policies by race, and what's happening. But I hope that all of us will get in there as the new administration is preparing to rewrite this survey, because it is our main mechanism for accountability, and I think it will have an awful lot of impact on both the prison pipeline and on what we're doing in schools, because that's where we track who is doing really how well. And so I hope that all of us will get involved in trying to make sure that this instrument is going to be a real instrument of accountability as we go forward. And Ruslan Ali, who is also an old CDF, is now in charge of the civil rights compliance people. But I hope we will all get in there and work hard, because I think this will be a great thing going forward.
We will close the session if the video person is ready to show there's some good news. It's been pretty depressing for the last hour or so. But in fact, there are some real constructive alternatives that have been identified. And I think if you look at this as we end, you'll see that the Children's Defense Fund has laid out for us what we can and what we should do, if we'll show it now.
The children.
I just feel good every morning. Feel good about going to Freedom School, learning something new.
We wanted to breathe life into them, and that's what we were able to do this summer.
When you come here, it's like you just get like rejuvenated and pumped up, and you know, just surrounded by so many positive people.
Teachers as a whole across the country need to participate in this somehow in some capacity. It changes you, it gives you a different perspective of life, you know, working with children.
We really love the Freedom School approach because it uses an intergenerational theme, the college interns providing a role model for kids who desperately need role models.
I mean, I know I always wanted to work with kids, but this is just such like a reaffirming and like reassurance that, you know, that is definitely what I want to do with my life.
One of the biggest things I think that Freedom School does for our kids is to help them find their individuality and still be a part of a team.
There's been two or three interns who have been there for a pretty long time. It seems like we really connected and they've helped me along the way. It really inspires me to go to college to make something out of my life.
I think about when I was a little kid and how the older kids used to be a leader for me and how I can be a leader for them.
It's always good to look up to someone because it inspires you to do what they do. Me being older now, it really makes me feel good to see that younger people are looking up to me as a role model or a friend.
It encourages children to not only be concerned about their society, but it also teaches them to love their culture no matter what culture.
The educational and cultural enrichment component was fantastic. The curriculum that the kids used, for once in their lives, it was almost as if it was targeted just for them, with the characters and the story that looked like them.
If someone had never seen Harambe talk, they would probably be shocked because they see all these kids in the morning, excited.
You get to dance.
Mini society is to prepare you for when you become an adult.
We learn how to be an entrepreneur. We learn how to start a business.
You sell items and you make money. You make a profit.
It's like making a community of businesses.
We have something called Deer Time, meaning drop everything and read.
And books you find lots of words and they're fun.
They're more poised to learn than what they're usually accustomed to because you are making it fun for them to learn.
I have lots of favorite books.
Nappy hair. Yeah, nappy hair. That's my favorite book because it teaches me about culture and it's funny.
I feel like I'm coming a part of the book. I just close my eyes and I think about it. When I get done reading the book, then I just become a part of it. It's just so amazing.
They want to write more. I remember I gave my children my address to college, and they were actually writing me all the time. And here's children that started out in the program. I don't want to write that story. I don't want to do this.
When I write my poetry, I just think about big words, how I can put them together into a poem.
It would be good for them to start more freedom schools because, I mean, what could be better than kids being in a safe place, doing safe things with safe people, and reading and doing those things, what could be better?
I began to understand the things that they was talking about in freedom school, and it really touched my heart.
What we see happening is a community being born,